Good day to you. Today we will be talking about movement of substances. Why are we studying this topic is because in biology, living materials and cells, they can't talk to each other, or they can't send materials to each other via parcels and things like that. Okay, so they use methods like diffusion, osmosis, active transport to share materials and to communicate to one another. Okay, first things first is diffusion. The most direct example will be seeing the smoke that comes out of cigarette, how it slowly equilibrates with the air around them, how it slowly disappears. The smoke that comes out of incense, a drop of paint in water as well, how the molecules move to achieve equilibrium. So the definition of diffusion will be the net movement of particles from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. It's also known as moving down a concentration gradient. Diffusion can also happen across membranes. This is particularly important, especially when it comes to cells, because cells are covered in membranes, as we understood in the previous video. For diffusion, in our lungs, the air is exchanged by means of diffusion, where oxygen is diffused into the bloodstream and carbon dioxide diffuses out of the bloodstream and is expelled through out of the body via breathing. Okay, that's quite simple. The next one we'll be talking about is osmosis. Osmosis is basically just the movement of water molecules from a region of higher water potential to a region of lower water potential through a partially permeable membrane. Okay, that sounds like really complicated, but actually it's not. You just think of it as the concentration of water, but that is in layman terms. You don't call water being concentrated because you don't dissolve water in water and call it concentrated. So it's the amount of water that with respect to the other material around it. So water potential is like the ratio of water molecules to the other materials within the whole volume of solvent, within the whole volume of liquid, as compared to its neighboring regions. So we are talking about more dilute solutions, it will have higher water potential than something that is concentrated, because the ratio of a dilute solution has more percentage of water inside. So you can see in this example on the left side, there is a higher amount of water ratio as compared to the one on the left. And if osmosis was to happen in this container, it will move from the left to the right. So how does osmosis affect living cells? So as we understood from the previous chapter, there are plant cells, there are animal cells. Okay, so we look at the plant cell first. Plant cells are encased in cell wall. The cell wall is inelastic, as the plant cell is exposed to solution with high water potential. The water will enter the cell and it becomes turgid. Okay, the turgor pressure will increase, so the cell expands a little bit and becomes tight. If the plant cell is exposed to region with lower water potential, then water from the cell leaves, and as a result, it becomes plasmolyzed. The cell membrane becomes a little bit detached from the cell wall. So this results in the plant cell becoming flaccid. As for animal cell, if animal cells are exposed to high water potential, water enters, and if there's too much water, it explodes. Okay, now it just expands and bursts, doesn't explode, because it does not have the cell wall like the plant cell has. If the animal cell is exposed to low water potential, it will undergo a process called crenation. Water leaves the cell and there are these spikes that form. These spikes are actually just formed by microtubules. It's like the little skeletons of a cell. There are other organelles inside that is just like the syllabus. So it helps. These little skeletons help to hold the shape. Don't worry too much about it. Okay, turgor pressure, as mentioned earlier, is important in plants because it helps them to keep upright and stay in shape, for leaves to receive maximum amount of sunlight, for flowers to bloom, for stomata to open so that gaseous exchange can take place. If they are limp, or let's say they lose turgor pressure, the plant will undergo a wilting process. So just a simple understanding, surface area to volume ratio. So cells are small because they need to have efficient material exchange with its surroundings and react quickly so that it is able to survive. Okay, and the last one for active transport, this is only for your science student. Active transport is the process in which cells use energy to pull materials from a region of lower concentration to a region of higher concentration. So this is a little bit different from the earlier two examples, diffusion and osmosis. It pulls material to itself against a concentration gradient. Active transport occurs only in living things, because living things create, or rather they expend energy through respiration. So energy is created for this process to take place. So So an example would be the root hair cell. They pull in nutrients from the surroundings through active transport as well, other than diffusion. Another example would be the uptake of glucose by cells in the villi, the small intestine, for active transport. And yes, that is about it for this chapter. Hope you enjoyed. Share this with somebody who needs to see this and do subscribe. And I'll see you in the next video.